إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله تعالى فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. طه، ما أنزلنا عليك القرآن لتشقى إلا تذكرة لمن يخشى، تنزيلا ممن خلق الأرض والسماوات العلى، الرحمن على العرش استوى. فإن أصدق الكتاب كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. أما بعد. Dear brothers and sisters and my elders, there is no doubt that we are living in difficult times. Whenever we turn on the news and we look at what is happening around the world to Muslims, it does paint a very gloomy picture. In our own country, just last week, 6 people were killed in cold blood just for going to the house of Allah. When we look at things like this, it brings about a sense of becoming overwhelmed, that practicing Islam is becoming difficult for me. That some of you may think, should I even be visibly Muslim? When I go to the workplace, when I'm in college, when I'm in school, when I'm in university, people give me the look. They say things behind my back. I think holding on to this faith is becoming increasingly difficult for me. Such a thought is very easy to come into our minds, looking at the political and looking at the reality around us. Now, do we think, I want us to consider this, do we think that the Prophet ﷺ, his life was a bed of roses? Did we think that the Prophet ﷺ, or do we think that the Prophet ﷺ never faced problems? Do we think that he never faced calamities? Where to did the Prophet ﷺ then turn to gain that support? Who did the Prophet ﷺ turn to for help? It is precisely in moments like these, brothers and sisters, that we need to look back at the life of our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to have mercy on the 6 people who were killed. We ask Allah from the depths of our hearts that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts them as martyrs and shuhada. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to have mercy on the Muslims around the world who are facing difficulties, who are facing calamities and tragedies. But what is it that you and I can do? How can you and I gain this support and that fortification in the foundations of our faith? Who do we turn to? And that is why I recited the first 5 ayat of the 20th surah of the Quran, Surah Taha. Surah Taha was revealed during the Meccan era of the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet, peace be upon him, as you all know, faced a lot of difficulties during the Meccan stage. So this surah was revealed primarily to accomplish 2 objectives. The first objective is to support and solidify the foundations of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And one of the most practical ways that this is accomplished is through giving a role model, through explaining to someone who is going through difficulties that you should tell this person that, do you know what? There were those before you who faced similar, if not more, difficulty than you. So have patience. Good times are coming. So which personality, which figure that does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala paint and show and illustrate to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? The example of the mighty messenger Moses, peace be upon him, Musa alayhi salam. The second objective that this surah sought to accomplish is that Allah acknowledges the difficulty faced by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah says, I understand what you're going through, Ya Rasulullah. I see what you're going through. And by extension, all of us, dear Muslims, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling you and I have not forsaken you. I have not left you. So turn back to the book of Allah and look at what guidance is contained in it. And that is my main objective of doing today's khutbah, brothers and sisters. I don't want us leaving today's Jumu'ah with a very gloomy picture of life. That we leave today's Jumu'ah and think, oh my God, things are going south. Look at across the border, what's happening. And then we start thinking that, subhanAllah, things are tough for the Muslims. No, I want us, in fact, to go home with a renewed faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is what this surah will do for us. So let us get straight into the surah. Allah begins the surah by saying, Taha. Now quickly, Taha, what's the meaning of Taha? There are many opinions floating out there. The first opinion, or one of those opinions, is that these disjointed letters, they're called the muqatta'at in the Arabic language. So you see alif, lam, mim, you see ha, mim, yasin, taha. What do these mean? One opinion says these are the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another opinion says these are the names of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But all of these opinions have absolutely no basis to them. In fact, the most relied upon authentic opinion is we leave and surrender the meanings of these muqatta'at, these disjointed letters, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah alone knows what their true meanings are. However, the scholars of tafsir have attempted to mention some wisdoms of why Allah uses these disjointed letters. Yasin, Hamim, Asin, Mim. What is the wisdom in this? One of the wisdoms, and I'll leave you with this, is a profound wisdom that the scholars mention, and that is that Allah is conveying to mankind that this speech, this Quran that I'm challenging you with, that bring forth a surah like it, bring forth an ayah like it, this surah that you're not, or this Quran that you're completely dumbfounded at, you're awestruck at, it is miraculous in origin, yet it uses your own language. It uses your own alphabets. It uses your own letters. Yet you are shocked and amazed at what the content of this book is. The Quraysh understood this is not the speech of a madman. They understood this is not the speech of a soothsayer. They understood this is not the speech of poetry. It's not prose. They understood this is something completely out of this world. And that is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is illustrating by using the disjointed letters. That I'm using your own tongue, your own language, yet you're not able to come forth with anything similar to it. So Allah begins the surah by saying, Taha, ma anzalna alayka al-Qur'an litashqa. A rough translation is, and we did not reveal this Qur'an upon you to bring about misery, to cause you distress. SubhanAllah. Allah Azza wa Jal is telling the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this deen, this Quran has not come down to make you miserable, to bring about distress in your life. In other words, you and me, Allah is telling us, this deen is not sent to you so that you would feel that life is becoming difficult. So that you would feel that, oh my God, things are so hard for me. No. Allah says, مَا أَنزَلْنَا عَلَيْكَ الْقُرْآنَ لِتَشْقَى. Let's pay attention to the word لِتَشْقَى. It comes from the word شَقَاوَى. شَقَاوَى means to be constantly struck by misfortune. شَقَاوَى is the person who, whenever he turns to anything in his life, he is struck by tragedies. He's struck by calamities. Allah is saying, This is not the purpose for which we brought down this Quran. Now look at the word ma. Ma, which is the beginning of ayah number 2 of Surah Taha, Allah Azza wa Jal, generally in the Quran, when the word ma is used, it is used to negate or refute something. Generally in the Quran, the word ma is used to negate or refute something. But specifically in this ayah, it is negating an idea that someone may already have about something. What do I mean by this? The Quraysh would come to the Prophet ﷺ and say to him, what has this deen brought to you anyways? What has this Quran even accomplished in your life? You were known as the Sadiqul Amin, as the one who is truthful and trustworthy amongst us. Look at the status you used to enjoy. Even now we understand that you're still trustworthy, but look at all the propaganda around. People are calling you a soothsayer, they're calling you a madman, your followers are being persecuted. What did this Quran even help do to your life? Look at how your life has completely turned upside down. Do you think the Prophet ﷺ would not be affected by this rhetoric? Does this sound familiar? In our times, don't we hear this propaganda? Don't we hear this thing around us in our times? So don't be dismissive, although some of you may make the argument that he was the Rasul of Allah, he was the Nabi. He would make dua to Allah, Allah would fortify him, Allah would support him, Allah would give him that strength. You and I are just mere mortals, we're just believers. Who is gonna support us? No, brother, it's getting very difficult. But I am here to tell you, dear brothers and sisters, don't think the Prophet ﷺ was a superhuman being. Don't think he was a legendary figure. The Prophet ﷺ was affected by this speech. He was affected. He did feel sad. He did feel remorse in his heart. That people are just my own people who loved me so much now are bad-mouthing me to such a great extent. All I see around society is nothing but venom espoused against me and my religion and my people. Do you think it didn't affect him? So do not be dismissive of the fact that the Prophet ﷺ did face so much problems on a psychological level, on a physical level. So what does Allah do? Allah comes to the defense of the Rasul ﷺ. مَا أَنزَلْنَا عَلَيْكَ الْقُرْآنَ لِتَشْقَى. We have not revealed this Qur'an to bring about difficulty in your life. So in other words, Allah is coming to the defense of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah is conveying to these Quraysh that all of this trash talk that the Quraysh is doing, Ya Rasulullah, it should not affect you. Don't worry about what they're saying. I am here to strengthen you. I am here to support you. Do you think then, O Muslims, Allah will not support us? Because of this tragedy that happened, that we stopped coming to the masajid for Salatul Isha, that we stopped going to the masjid for Salatul Fajr, that is exactly what Shaytan, our sworn enemy, wants. That you get paralyzed by that fear. But we will not get paralyzed by fear. No, our Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who was sent as an example for us, he did not allow fear to paralyze him. مَا أَنزَلْنَا عَلَيْكَ الْقُرْآنَ لِتَشْقَى. The third word I want us to focus on in this ayah is the word عَلَيْكَ. Allah speaks in the first person to the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The word عَلَيْكَ means to reveal something upon someone. عَلَيْكَ, upon you. Now there are two prepositions in the Arabic language that can be used. عَلَيْكَ or إِلَيْكَ. To be sent with a message, and a message to be sent upon someone. Now in the English language, it may sound very similar. Okay, to be sent with a message, to send a message upon. It's all the same thing. Yes, perhaps in the English language it is, but in the Arabic it is not. In the Arabic language, the word alayka that is used in this ayah, it demonstrates, it conveys the meaning of obligation. It conveys the meaning of responsibility. Ya Rasulullah, this Quran has been revealed upon you as an obligation, as a responsibility that you act upon it and then you propagate it. Now, someone may say, but that was the job of the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was a da'i. I'm not a da'i. I'm not an imam. I'm not a preacher. I'm not a scholar. How does this relate to me? Well, guess what? It relates to you. The fact that you are a believer, Whenever you're walking on the streets, you're shopping in the malls, whenever you're riding the subway or taking the bus, whenever you're interacting with others, you are being noticed. You are a walking, talking ambassador of Islam, whether you like it or not. So you are being seen. So Allah is saying this is a responsibility upon you. Act upon this and propagate it. You don't have to be a scholar to propagate the teachings of Islam. Your demeanor, your actions speak louder than words. مَا أَنزَلْنَا عَلَيْكَ الْقُرْآنَ لِتَشْقَى إِلَّا تَذْكِرَةً لِمَنْ يَخْشَى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala goes further. Allah says, it will only be a reminder to someone who fears. Who fears? What does this mean? Exactly as the ayah says. That a person who comes to this book with arrogance in his heart, that he comes to this book thinking that he already knows better than what the book contains, this person will not gain reminders from this. But a person who comes and fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he fears the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he or she will gain benefit from this surah and from this Quran. Inshallah ta'ala, in this second khutbah, we'll talk about some more gems that are contained in the surah and talk about some practical steps that we can take in connecting back with this guidance and the book of Allah. بَارَكَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ فِي الْقُرْآنِ الْكَرِيمِ وَنَفَعَنِي وَإِيَّاكُمْ بِالْآيَاتِ وَذِكْرِ الْحَكِيمِ إِنَّهُ تَعَالَى جَوَادٌ كَرِيمٌ وَمَلِكٌ بَرٌّ وَرَحِيمٌ. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهدي الله تعالى فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. وبعد. You know the distress that this surah starts off with. It's not about the message that the Quran came with. The message is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The distress and the difficulty that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam faced was the fact that those he was conveying this message to were not accepting. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was so grieved by this. And that this is what made this man so incredibly amazing. It is the concern he had for humanity, for their guidance. The Prophet ﷺ had seen what no other person had seen. The Prophet ﷺ saw Jannah and Jahannam. He knew the punishment that awaited those who rejected the message. The Prophet ﷺ was so concerned, a type of concern, dear brothers and sisters, that we cannot even fathom. A type of concern that you and I cannot even come to terms with. This is how much concern the Prophet ﷺ had for the guidance of you and I. Then we will just let go of this legacy of the Rasul ﷺ, that we think we cannot practice the faith anymore. No, never, subhanAllah. We cannot let this ever happen. In one place in the Quran, Allah is telling the Prophet ﷺ that it is your responsibility to give the message. Yet, in another place, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Kahf, Surah 18, ayah number 6, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَلَعَلَّكَ بَاخِعٌ نَفْسَكَ عَلَىٰ آثَارِهِمْ إِن لَّمْ يُؤْمِنُوا بِهَذَا الْحَدِيثِ أَسَفًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, perhaps you would kill yourself through grief of them not accepting the message. Out of sorrow you will kill yourself, ya Rasulullah. That in the heart of the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he felt so much pain and sorrow when people would reject the message, that Allah is consoling the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He's saying, calm down. It's okay, ya Rasulullah. You don't have guidance in your hand, guidance is from me. But look at the pain, the sorrow the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam had for those who would leave the message. Subhanallah. In a beautiful hadith, and I'll end with this, the Prophet ﷺ says, as is reported in Sahih Muslim, مَثَلِي وَمَثَلُكُمْ كَرَجُلٍ أَوْقَدَ نَارًا. The Prophet ﷺ says that my example and your example is like a man who has kindled a fire. And seeing that illumination, that light, The moths and the grasshoppers and the crickets and these insects are rushing toward it, thinking that it is light. And the Prophet ﷺ said, I am holding you from the back by your shoulders and by your waist. I am pushing you away from the fire. You're thinking it is light, but it is not light. It is the fire that will cause your destruction. وَأَنْتُمْ تُفْلِتُونَ مِنْ يَدِي And you are just slipping away from my fingers. Look at the expression that Rasul ﷺ is using. You're just slipping away from my fingers. This is how much compassion the Rasul ﷺ had for you and I, for our guidance. Even the word that he's using, you're just leaving me. You're just slipping like water slips away. SubhanAllah, let us reconnect with our legacy. Let us not let whatever events happen, never let that cause us to let go of our faith. Tie your camel, yes. Whenever you see any kind of, and this is the practical advice, whenever you see any kind of suspicious activity, whether it's in the darkness of a masjid, you've come for Salatul Fajr or Isha, you're at a shopping mall or you're at a parking lot, you notice anything suspicious, call law enforcement. Alert them. Let them know that you're seeing things like this. When you're coming to the masjid, carpool, come together. And inshallah, Allah will be with you the way Allah was with the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. تَنْزِيلًا مِمَّنْ خَلَقَ الْأَرْضَ وَالسَّمَاوَاتِ الْعُلَىٰ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that this message, in case you're thinking it's something easy, something cheap, Allah says no. It is coming down from the one who created the earth and the one who created the skies. تَنْزِيلًا مِمَّنْ خَلَقَ الْأَرْضَ وَالسَّمَاوَاتِ الْعُلَىٰ What could be higher than the skies? You see, as believers, we take this deen for granted. We think it's something cheap, it's okay if I pray, it's okay if I don't pray, it's okay if I fast the month of Ramadan. SubhanAllah, this deen is coming out of love and compassion from the one who created the earth and the skies. And you know something remarkable about the Quran? When some thought comes in your mind, the next ayah answers that thought. What could be higher than the skies? Allah says in ayah number 5, Al-Rahman, ala al-arsh istawa. Allah says, what is higher above than the skies? Is Ar-Rahman, who rose above the throne in a manner that suits His Majesty. Ar-Rahman wa ala al-arsh istawa. Don't take this deen as something cheap. Don't take this message, this Quran, as something that is cheap. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the depths of my heart that He causes us to appreciate this message, that He causes us to appreciate the sacrifices that the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam made, that the sacrifices that the Sahaba made, that the sacrifices the generations of Muslims made, so that today you and I could say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I ask Allah that He makes us from those who are flag carriers of the Sunnah, that He makes us from those who love this deen and love the Sunnah of the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I ask Allah that He protects the Muslimin wherever they are. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to have mercy upon those who have passed away, that Allah grants them the highest levels of paradise. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to have mercy on those of our loved ones who are sick, who are not well, that Allah gives them a purification from this disease, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala causes them to be cured, that leaves behind no illness whatsoever. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. Ibadallah, rahmatullah. Inna Allah ya'mu bil adli wal ihsan wal ita'i al-qurba wa yanha anil fahshari wal munkari wal baghi ya'idhukum la'allakum tadhakkarun. Udhkurullaha dhikran kathiran wa sabbihuhu bukratan wa asila. Wa ladhikrullahi akbar. Aqim as-salam.